2016, New Beginnings, Active Hope. And our special guest tonight to talk to us has written a book called Active Hope, and I recommend it highly to you. If you, like me, get discouraged at times with the state of the world. And I just want to read a couple of sentences from a letter I got the other day. This is from Peace Action Education Fund. And this person writes, "Dear friend, it's been a tough world, a tough year for our world. Drifting, it seems, ever deeper into the throes of war and terror, accelerating climate disaster, continuous assault on civil rights, and growing poverty and inequity. Fear grows our confidence in the ability of our leaders and institutions to save us erodes. Conflicting agendas, competing priorities, and half-baked policies will not nurture the hope we need to carry with us as we deal with these existential threats. A larger military budget won't cure what ails us. Your year-end tax-deductible gift to Peace Action, I'm not going to go on. But I think that really describes where so many of us are. It can look really hopeless, and we can feel really enervated. We really feel sometimes like we just don't have what we need to go on and keep fighting, and some of us like to kind of look away from the Diablo Canyon and Guantanamo prison and the police murders that are happening on a daily basis. But we can't stay there. We just can't stay there. I can't stay there. I have to do something. I have a kid. I have a child. She's grown up. I care about her, and I care about what happens in this world. And I want to introduce Joanna Macy now, whose life work really is to help us face what we have to face. Come on up, Joanna, please. Joanna Macy.
You are the hope. I love this, that you are bringing together these different issues. But each one of the issues, I think, that you brought together here, and let this be the beginning of many, many more meetings where we interweave these issues, because they all have to do with empire, with the new, old, new in a new mask, the imperialism, the effrontery, the daring that you can. Oh, aren't you tired of feeling ashamed of your own country?
Yeah,
but we here are going to be and are the hopeful face of our country. So I really want to talk about what hope is, because this was a word that for years I didn't use. I would say things like, hope is a killer, or hope distracts you from what you need to face. And look at the Buddha's teachings, you don't find hope in any of it. It takes you away from the present moment. It puts you into, and now I see that there is a way that we can wipe the film from our glasses, shake ourselves awake, and see what hope really is. So that was the gist of this book that grew out of a partnership with a friend of mine in United Kingdom in England. And we wrote it together across the Atlantic Ocean and by Skype, and we called it Active Hope, How to Face the Mess We're In Without Going Crazy. And the key thing that writing this with Chris Johnstone, who's a medical doctor who was working with addictions, and he was ready to look at a worldwide global culture that's spreading, which is a culture of addiction, to what the new economic order, new imperialism seeks to provide us. So hope then, in a word, is not something that you have. It's something you do. It's a verb. You don't wait around until you feel optimistic and hopeful. Hope is what springs from your desire, springs from your caring. Hope is a response to a calling you feel. It's a caring for our world. It's a practice, like Tai Chi or gardening. It's something we do rather than have. We cultivate through our caring and cultivating the courage to answer our calling. And it stems from looking straight in the face of what we're doing to our world and what is done to our world in our names. And it has everything to do with linking arms with other people. So one day as we were talking on Skype, I just started a kind of riff. And this is, and he then, Chris, put it verbatim in there, and I'm gonna read it to you. Active hope is not wishful thinking. Active hope is not waiting to be rescued by the Lone Ranger or by some savior. Active hope is waking up to the beauty of life. Waking up to the beauty of life on whose behalf we can act. You are, and we are, lucky enough to be capable of falling in love with life at a moment when it needs our response. We're awake and alive now. We belong to this world. The web of life is calling us forth at this time. We've come a long way over the billions of years that have shaped life on this beautiful planet. And we're here to play our part. With active hope, we realize that there are adventures in store, strengths to discover, and comrades to link arms with. Active hope is a readiness to engage. Are you beginning to recognize yourself as I'm reading this? Do you know that you are being described in this? Active hope is a readiness to engage and a readiness to discover the strengths in ourselves and in others. A readiness to discover the reasons for hope and the occasions for love. A readiness to discover the size and strength of our hearts, our quickness of mind, our steadiness of purpose. Ready to discover that again and again. Readiness to discover our own authority and our love for life. To rediscover the liveliness of our curiosity and this unsuspected deep well of patience and diligence. To rediscover the keenness of our senses and our capacity to lead. None of these can be discovered in an armchair or without risk. Mm-hmm. What I love about this way of seeing hope is that you can do it, cultivate that, even when you're feeling discouraged. If hope is a verb, then it's something you can do even when you're feeling hopeless. Now, I really like that, because in our culture, I believe that there is much too much emphasis, value put on optimism. It actually can encourage a kind of mental sloppiness. Well, I'm really optimistic, but we say this as if it were some form of personal failing to actually look and say I'm pessimistic. It really doesn't look good, does it? This is a problem that America is unique, I think, mostly to America. And our brothers and sisters in Europe roll their eyes when we feel that way. You know, we inherited that from, you know, as a country based on hope and manifest destiny, and the successful person is ready with all the answers and brimming with grims and optimism, even when it's asinine. So I'll tell you a story of what happened to me. There was a period in my life which changed my life. When, having worked on environmental and social justice issues, I went to a large colloquium put on in Boston by the Cousteau Society. And there was days of it, and I took my second son and my daughter with me, and we wandered through, and I knew all the facts. I knew about the oil spills. I knew about the clubbing of the baby seals. I knew about the refusal to acknowledge what we were putting on the soil, etc. So I knew it, but there, it all came together and I felt, oh my God, I didn't even have words for it. There was something that, I felt that there was some pins being pulled out from where I kept all that knowledge up at the top of my head, and it cascaded down to my heart, into my body. And I opened my heart mind to the fact, to the realization that we could do ourselves in. This was back in 40 years ago, 77. It wasn't that I was sure we were going to end life on Earth, but that it was possible for us to do that. And that changed everything. And is characterized, I struggled with that for almost a year. I didn't want to tell people about it. I didn't want to tell my family. I didn't want them to worry about me. I didn't want to tell my friends and my colleagues at the university. I didn't want to be considered a morbid and depressing person. Because I love life, but I had this terrible grief. And then what happened was, something prompted me. Maybe I got bored with it. I went and joined a group, volunteered for a tiny task force in an organization called Critical Mass that Ralph Nader had brought together. Thank you. I just love that. That was on nuclear power. And this little group, we were four. There was me and three law students, half my age, and they were so shocked, and I was so proud to be in their company. And because I wasn't trained in the law, they told me what I could do. You go look this up, and look, you can look up the health statistics. At that point, you could actually walk into the Nuclear Regulatory Commission on H Street in Washington, D.C., where my family and I were living, can you believe it? And walk upstairs and walk into the library and I found Wasserman. And anyway, working with them, we were suing the Virginia Electric Power Company to stop racking the fuel rods too close together in the fuel pools. They were disobeying the regulations that keep them a certain distance so they don't bring each other to critical condition. I felt this was what? The best thing. This is the best thing, to be working on something you care about with people you admire. What's better than that? The best meals, the best banquet doesn't hold a candle to being able to plot and plan and to respect these youngsters that I was working with. And the fact that we failed did not in any way diminish my joy and my appreciation, my gratitude for being able to do that work with them. That's what I wanted to reflect with myself and with you. That what you're doing right here, you are bringing forth the best in each other. You are demonstrating the best in yourselves, that you are caring for something beyond your skin, that you are extending your self-interest to issues that affect the world, your whole country. That's considered in Buddhism the most precious thing. It's like a flame in the heart. It's called bodhicitta. It's the capacity to care about and serve something beyond yourself. Isn't that the best? Come on, really? And when you get used to that, you never get enough of it. And you find that you're learning to something about the nature of power. That the collaboration brings forth things you never expected. What in systems we call emergent properties, where you put your head together with another's head and another, and what comes forward out of that collaboration is something that you could not have expected. That's how evolution happens, actually. Yeah. So my friends, go to, and I am grateful. And I want some of the magic that you're making as you bring together all the different issues that are passionate in your heart to spread out across this town and this state and this land. The times need it. The times need you. You in your act of hope.
We usually give a pink badge of courage. Tonight we're giving this beautiful pink cyclamen to Joanna to thank her so much for her lifelong commitment and for joining us tonight. And so grateful to you, Joanna. Thank you so much.
Cynthia is going to come up. Joanna, thank you so much. We're so greatly in your debt, and have a wonderful trip to Sri Lanka. We will miss you in the body, but not the spirit. It's wonderful that you came. Thank you so much.
Same back at you.
So we are now, this is a magnificent group, by the way. Most of these people have been here since 4:30, and it's just been really tremendous, a gorgeous fantastic and incredibly powerful group of people. And so our emphasis is on taking action. And we have a group of people locally who are trying to bring forth the power of the community into this town. And they're going to be followed. John Simon is here, a great author. This being an election year, there's a small issue about whether our votes are actually going to be counted. And so John and I are going to talk about that. But first, we want to bring forward the folks. Don Goldmacher.
Don Goldmacher and Adolfo Cabral from the Berkeley Progressive Alliance are going to come up and tell us about this new huge alliance that's forming so we can get a progressive mayor and city council in Berkeley. Don Goldmacher.
Well, this is really, really impressive, and thank you for inviting us. Don and I flipped a coin and I lost, so here I am. It's a hard act to follow. It's wonderful to hear that. We are the Berkeley Progressive Alliance. We were just born about 6 or 10 weeks ago. We are the offspring of a large group of folks, some between 90 and 200, depending on which mailing list we look at. Offsprings from the Sustainable Berkeley Coalition, which has been moving and active in fighting City Hall against the project at Harold Way. And in the awareness of all that needs to be done, especially with an election year coming up, we decided to form an election subcommittee, and from that election subcommittee came the idea of producing a coalition of Berkeley progressives. I feel like I'm preaching to the choir here because you know what I'm talking about.
Right.
And so essentially the Berkeley Progressive Alliance, and we have terrible media knowledge at this point, and so our flyer looks like a small newspaper and it's over on the table, but it essentially expresses what we are trying to do. And what we are trying to do is coalesce the progressive vote in Berkeley. There are a lot of great grassroots organizations and all over town, but what we would like to try to do is to bring that consciousness together, to bring all those divergent awarenesses and potentials and hopes and activists together under one umbrella that says we are Berkeley progressives and we demand representation in our city hall. The only thing that's going to change anything is our local governance. Everything is local, no matter how big the cause. If it doesn't start in this room and in many rooms around our city, it really is just another news headline, another news story, another news day, and onward and onward. The important thing, I think, is to awaken the voters. And I am hoping that the energy of this type of meeting can be cloned and multiplied in the various districts and neighborhoods and communities throughout the city to get this awareness to the voters. There are a lot of, how should I say it, apathetic voters, unaware of the details that are necessary to make big changes in our small pond. And if we can do that, if we can go out neighborhood by neighborhood, community by community, and educate the voters as to the history of what our politicians have been doing to us for the past 8-10 years, last two terms, how we need to change that message and how we need to change that point of view in City Hall, that is what we are trying to do through the Berkeley Progressive Alliance, is go to the neighborhoods, create town halls, create forums for neighbors to meet with neighbors, to discuss ideas, to disagree, to argue, but at least to get a message out that we must communicate with each other and must listen to good ideas, and then put our shoulders to work to get more voters, younger voters, and active voters to change the system that we are living under locally. So essentially, I guess I've come to that. all of it's here. Much better said than what I can do. It'll be on the table. Please take one. Please contact us. Get on our mailing list, and we hope to have more sessions like this. And I would really encourage everyone to try to give us ideas. Send us emails where we can meet with new neighbors, with new communities, with new people around the city to get the Berkeley Progressive Vote together for next year's election. Thank you.
Well, Brother Adolfo said it all very well, so I'm not going to say much more, except I want to show you an example of what we've done thus far. We put on an affordable housing teach-in on November 22nd, 2015, which was attended by almost 200 people from people who live in Berkeley. One of our critical foci, the other focus obviously, is on the mayoral race, which is not clear who's entering in and who's not. We know there are two candidates thus far. That's Lori Capitelli, who's a real estate broker, who's made a godzilla amount of money off of the development that's occurring in the city and the rampant speculation. Jesse Arrigan is a current city council person who has done a lot of progressive stuff, and he's running for mayor. The other critical point we'd like to make is there's an 800-pound gorilla in the city of Berkeley. It's called the University of California. Now, the University of California used to be educating our children for free. It is now essentially a 501c3 tax-exempt corporation, the majority of whose money comes from corporations and from rich students coming from out of state. So it's no longer a public university, but it has the veneer of a public university, while it gobbles up real estate in the city of Berkeley.
Realtors and families trying to move into Berkeley. It's a very important.
Gee, I'm getting feedback from Moni. And most people in the city are totally unaware of the role of the university, and especially the private deal that took place between Mayor Tom Bates and the university shortly after Mayor Bates took office in his first term. And that deal essentially capped how much money the university owes the city. And since that time, the university is continuing to buy up commercial real estate around the city, thus lowering the tax base, the commercial tax base of the city. And all of the new housing development that's going up at market rate, that's not just for the techies who work in Silicon Valley. That's for the new goal of 50,000 students at the University of California, Berkeley campus. Those students will be sharing four to a room, three to a room, as we saw recently Berkeley Gardens, where the catastrophe happened. You know, and six Irish students lost their lives from the shoddy construction. If you think there's no more shoddy construction going on, guess again. Anyway, I'll leave it there. We really invite everybody to be part of this. We're going to need everybody involved on the ground, knocking on doors, encouraging people to register to vote, and then getting them out to vote. Because Harvey will tell you how important that is if we're going to allow stolen elections.
Thank you, guys. It's, you know, I'll put politics over, but we'll figure this out at some point. When you do, you'll show it. So one of the things I've been working on, just getting the timer going here, for many years is because of living in Central Ohio, in 2004, they stole the presidential election. You know, John Kerry was the rightful winner in 2004. The one good thing we can say about George W. Bush is that he was never elected president of the United States by the American people. And since then, things have actually gotten worse. And people get depressed when we talk about this, but this is something we have to break through. So we're looking at a presidential election this year. I will guarantee you, in a fair vote count in this country, if there was an actual fair vote count, Bernie Sanders would be elected president. That's counterintuitive, but if you look at what the polls are saying, he is actually beating Donald Trump by way more than Hillary Clinton does. And so what we see now, and it's not the same here in Berkeley as it is in the rest of the country, but we do have to look at this issue, is that 80% of the vote in the United States will be cast on electronic voting machines. And most of the people will be registered officially on electronic poll books. And so the strategy, and I have a piece about this, it's up right now at Reader Supported News. And if you go to Reader Supported News online, you can read this piece with Mimi Kennedy about Fitrakis and me. And basically, the GOP strategy is to strip and flip. Strip the voter rolls of people who are suspected Democrats, mostly black people and Hispanics, and also young people, especially college students and the elders who are on Social Security. Strip them from the voter rolls, and Greg Palast has done the great reporting on this. He's a great investigative reporter. He was the one who first told the story about Florida 2000, and he continues to do so. And we are seeing millions of people stripped from the voter rolls right now by the Republicans to make sure that they don't vote in this coming election. Now, if that's not sufficient, and it probably even that won't be, you have to remember Obama literally won the 2008 and 12 elections by more than 10 million votes. Now, they lowered his vote count, but these were huge landslides that Obama won by, and there's no more Republican Party. The Republican Party is all smoke and mirrors now. It's basically a few corporations, and Phoebe is going to talk about that in a minute, with control of the media and a bunch of rich white guys. The rest of the country, the demographic has moved totally away from the Republican Party. And so all they can do now is strip the voter rolls and flip the election. And we're looking specifically at six swing states: Florida, North Carolina, Ohio, Michigan, Iowa, and Arizona. These six states have Republican governors and Republican secretaries of state. And so at midnight on election night, when they realize how badly they've lost, they will call in their IT person, and then they'll ask the IT person how long it'll take to flip the vote count, and then she'll say about 60 seconds. And they'll say, wherever they're caught, and she'll say no. So between now and election day, we have to do this. People tend to get depressed. We have to go to the court. We have to figure out exactly how to beat this system of election theft. Because we know that we have made enormous strides in public opinion. The American people don't want war. They're not particularly racist, really, when you get right down to it. And aside from the fact we're not even a majority white country anymore, certainly not California. All the demographics and all the issues have moved our direction. The biggest barrier we have to really moving power in this country is the electronic system of skipping and flipping voting. So it sounds very depressing, but it's something, look, we got to deal with it. It's just the way it is. Now, John Simon is here. John, is here, can I have this? In a night that proudly features Code Pink, he has done Code Red, which is a really one of the best, believe me, I've read them all, one of the very best books on election theft. And I've asked John to tell us, John has moved to California from...
In the process,
like me, coming from Boston. This book features one amazing section, which is the big mystery to all of us. Why did the Democrats put up with election theft? Why did John Kerry walk away from the 2004 election when we were telling him he had won, if he had $7 million in a fund to deal with fraudulent elections? And we told his people 250,000 votes were as yet uncounted, and at 1 o'clock the day after the election, when it was still very much in play, he conceded and went windsurfing. And, you know, in 2000, Al Gore won, and he went to the Supreme Court, and then said nothing. And none of these guys have said anything about it. So I've asked John to give us a psychoanalysis of the Democrats and why they have... Can you do that for us? Please.
Hi, Charlie. I probably can't do that, but, the truth is... We don't know. We're not inside the heads of John Kerry or Al Gore or Bernie Sanders. I'll tell you this. I mean, I'm going to give you hope, since we're focused on hope, and I think Harvey has alluded to it. The real hope here is that the country that we think, and all your colleagues and friends and serious people who care about people and plants and animals and the fate of the earth, all of the America that they think they're seeing and taking pretty much at face value is bullshit. It is a fraud of the electoral system. So that's where the hope lies, because this is a pretty simple thing, counting votes. I mean, in a democracy, one of the responsibilities of the people who vote should be to participate in the counting of the vote. So it should be something we can fix, right? And there's still plenty wrong. There's the media, there's the money, there's the gerrymandering, there are all those things. But unless you're contemplating revolution, and I don't see anybody here with a Che Guevara shirt on or any sort of, you know, heavy firearms or even, you know, smoke bombs. I mean, unless we're talking about revolution, it's the electoral system. That's what we have. That's what a democracy has. And right now, it has been subverted and corrupted systematically. I've been at this for 14 years, as has Harvey. And I can tell you, I do forensics. We collect evidence. We look at patterns. We keep seeing things hit us in the face where we say, that is just not frickin' possible. Over and over and over and over and over and over again. And we can't get traction with the Democratic Party. But let me go further, because we can't get traction with Bernie Sanders. Let me go further. We couldn't get traction with Lawrence Lessig. Does everybody know who Larry Lessig was?
Yes.
He ran a campaign. I mean, he's from my hometown, my adopted hometown, my work town, Cambridge, Massachusetts. He teaches down there at Harvard Law School. I've gone by his office. I've dropped off my book. I've written him letters. He ran a campaign. Based on what? Electoral integrity, cleaning up the electoral system, gerrymandering, right? Gerrymandering is a big thing, big money, right? He was gonna fix that. Voter ID issues, vote suppression, all of those things. This was his single issue campaign that he collected $1 million or so to go out and change the electoral system, conspicuously missing was the actual count of the votes. The man wouldn't touch it. I addressed him in public. I said, why the hell won't you touch this? Blah, 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 blah. Nothing that makes any sense. So if you can't get Larry Lessig, it's gonna be a hard swing to get Bernie Sanders, and it sure is gonna be a hard swing to get the Democratic Party. They don't wanna be marginalized. They don't wanna give up the power of the duopoly, which is doing very well, thank you, for both Democrats and Republicans, right? There are many reasons. In the book, I actually cite five, and that's just scratching the surface of reasons why the Democrats won't actually pay attention to the fact that election after election is being robbed. And by the way, Harvey referred, this is a presidential election year, so people actually get focused. And then the other 3 years, they just sort of say, ah, whatever. That ah, whatever is fatal. Because Karl Rove is always focused. If you give credit of any sort to the man, it is that he is focused. He cares. Why? I don't know. Maybe he just likes to win. I don't think he even has any political conviction, but boy, is he focused. And what did they focus on? They focused on the elections that you can steal without leaving any sort of trace. State legislative elections, US House elections, no exit polls, no nothing, no baseline for forensics, nothing. And there are thousands of those elections, and if you look around at this country right now, I mean, we may get a Democratic president in there, so what?
Exactly.
You got gridlock. And then eventually we're gonna elect a president who can work with Congress. Somebody like Marco Rubio, let's say, who can work with Congress. Because they've taken over the entire political infrastructure of this country. They own the state houses. They own the judicial systems in most of the states. They own the governorships. They own the attorney generals, the people you have to go to. I mean, California is an island, let's face it. So is Massachusetts in a way, right? Not everything's perfect here, but they don't care about Massachusetts. They don't care about California. They don't need that to stop the Supreme Court. They don't need that to block every progressive initiative. They don't need that to eventually institute Sharia law or whatever the hell they have on their minds. They don't need that, because they're gonna have the House, and for other reasons, they're gonna have the Senate. And not to say that it's hopeless, because this is all a mirage. The counting process has been subverted. It's that easy. And I could, you know, if we had more time, I could go into why it's so easy and exactly how you do it and what the evidence is, you know, what evidence we've collected to show that it's being done. That these machines are not just vulnerable, but they're actually being exploited. I mean, again, the highest stakes game you can imagine. This country was obsessed for 8 months about the air pressure in footballs. And they actually opened up a machine and looked at a memory card, the way they impounded the footballs and started testing their pressure. No, because football matters. But who governs this country and what this country does to the world apparently doesn't. So I'm going to leave it at that. I'm going to say, you know, there's a very strong psychological resistance to finding out that you've been duped. As a matter of fact, the research they've done shows that people would rather continue being duped than find out that they have been duped. And that's really at play here at many, many levels. What we need is we need to spread consciousness, spread awareness that we're better than this, that we can count our own votes, that we can have a democracy, that we can have an electoral system that is not handed over lock, stock, and barrel and outsourced to Karl Rove and Dominion and ES&S and all these rather shady far-right companies that are actually counting the votes. So, you know, where I leave this is I have written a book about this. It's comprehensive. It's rather readable. That was a big point of emphasis with me, is not to make it technical so the eyes don't glaze over. It's the kind of thing that if it actually got read, if it got on Oprah or, you know, Terry Gross even, or Charlie Rose, all things considered, and got it right, then, you know, and it spread and it started to sort of go viral the way things do in the information age, there would be a big step in the increase of consciousness and awareness. And that is really what we need, because the Democrats aren't going to do it. We saw Bernie Sanders is not likely to do it. Florence Lessig wasn't going to do it. It's got to be the people who do it. So I'm going to bring in some books. I'm going to have them for sale. There's a website. It's codered2014.com. And, you know, in a way, I mean, of course I want you to read it. I don't want you just to read it. And this is not, you know, financial interest here. This is just interest in the fate of the world, you know. This is really, really important that we get this moving. It's already pretty much, if I, you know, whisper it, pretty much too late. But if we're going to have any chance, we better act, and it better spread, and it better spread fast, so that we start counting the votes by humans, and we have a verified system of vote counting, so they can't just rig up, as Harvey says, whatever numbers they need at midnight on election night, whatever year it is, presidential or otherwise. So I'm going to bring in some of the books, and I hope you take a look. Okay, thanks very much. Thank you. You can't really call me. Yes.
I'm
an IT,
and
I understand
why and how we can steal elections and
these
obvious that both of them are stolen. And that county has decided to have
their votes counted by hand. Very good. So we do have a program, and I want to make sure it's clear. The program is 100% hand-counted paper ballots in all of the United States. And Germany, Ireland just got rid of their election machine, electronic voting machines. Germany, Ireland, Japan, Canada, they all have hand-counted paper ballots. We want automatic voter registration. Every human being, every citizen in this country who turns 18 is automatically registered to vote. These voter registration drives are silly. We have a four-day weekend to vote, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. It says in the Constitution we have to vote on Tuesday, but we don't have to change the Constitution to this. You know, states have a lot of leeway in how elections are done. So those 4 days, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, so the people, you know, don't have to take off work to vote, and then finally a national holiday to count the votes on that Tuesday, or we can do it on Wednesday. All the high school and college students in the country get the day off, they run the polls, and they count the ballots. It's very simple to do that. That is our goal. And you have to remember, you know, this is not a small issue, this is the biggest issue. Someone once said if elections could change anything, they'd be illegal. Well, actually elections are illegal because they're stolen from us now. If we ever get this system rationalized, if we solve this issue, we could have a revolution in this country by nonviolent means. It has happened elsewhere in the world. Okay? Thank you very much, John. John is going to be here for a while. We'll have his next kind of presentation. So, and thank you for your comment in the back there. Much appreciated. We're going to move on now because someone said, who is they? So they is the corporation. They is a cancerous tumor that has grown in this world. We have, among the, come on up, Phoebe. We have in the human race, in our human society, an entity that is above the law, right? It's been given human rights, but no human responsibilities. And it has one and only one genetic impulse, which is to make money. It has nothing to do with human need, nothing to do with the needs of the planet. That is the corporation. The corporation is the cancer that's killing the human race and killing our planet as we go along. And Phoebe here, who has the most beautiful smile in the world, is going to tell us how we're going to do it.
We've actually made some progress on that plane. And Berkeley, you know, is a cauldron, and it's important that we keep it so, because it's moved to the right, so I really appreciate the work of the Berkeley Progressive Alliance and Berkeley Citizens Action. We've got to get two more progressives. We only have 3 out of 9 progressives anymore, so there are a lot of 6-to-3 decisions that we don't like. But the rest of the country doesn't know that. When they read in the news that Berkeley did something conservative, it's so discouraging for them because they don't realize that our elected officials here now are more conservative than the electorate. Why? Because most of the Berkeley voters aren't really paying attention on the local level, only on the national level. And we have to do both. It's not enough to do just the local level. We have to think and act both locally and globally. It's the only thing, the only way we'll get things changed. So Berkeley actually stood up to the stolen election of 2004. We passed a resolution that was unanimous, and we worked very hard on it, and it had like a 10-point program calling for a lot of what Harvey mentioned. And sometimes these things spread, and they go nationwide, and lots of cities pass such things as Berkeley does, and then it really makes a difference. So Berkeley also was the first city in the nation to call for ending personhood, corporate personhood, back in 2004 when hardly anybody had heard of it. And Berkeley was the first city in the nation to object to Citizens United versus the FEC, which of course gave unlimited corporate spending for elections. And that now has spread. Now there have been hundreds and hundreds of cities who've called for a constitutional amendment ending corporate personhood and money being considered speech. So we have a lot of victories there, but we have to keep going, of course. So you all know this, the root problem, Monsanto poisoning our food supply, poisoning our land with PCBs, and Berkeley has joined the lawsuit against Monsanto. That's new. They decided that just last week, and Chris Worthington is responsible for that. He was here, but he had to leave. Council Member Chris Worthington. And is George Lipman here? I want to point out George Lipman, who chairs the Peace and Justice Commission that's done a lot of the things that the city council a lot of the things. So Berkeley also last year got a cell phone safety ordinance to inform people about cell phone safety, and we were sued, as expected, by the telecom industry, big telecom, and I guess who defended us? Who knows? Who here knows who defended us? Yes, call it out.
Larry Lessig
successfully defended Berkeley in that lawsuit, and we won. We only had to take out one little part about children being more. Isn't that ironic that it was that's like the loophole that. The thing that got us on that we had to take out was the children being more vulnerable. But the larger issue is still so. That's going to be a good thing that's going to happen. So fossil fuels, climate chaos, nuclear power, the U.S. being the largest weapons manufacturer, drones and torture for oil wars, all that goes back to what? What's the root reason for it? Yeah. I mean, I thought you were going to say 1% greed or 1% stupidity or short-sightedness.
Yes, but really, the corporation is the mechanism for that. So we have some more victories on that plane. The only way to reverse the Supreme Court decisions that gave the corporations the power to run and to ruin our world is what? How can we reverse the Supreme Court? Yep, constitutional amendment. And does anybody know the number of the amendment, the good one that's been introduced now in Congress?
28th Amendment.
Well, it will be the 28th Amendment. There have already been 27. It will be the 28th. But the number is House Joint Resolution 48. And more good news, it's getting more and more co-sponsors now. Our own Congresswoman Barbara Lee, after we've been working on it for like 12, 13 years, she finally is co-sponsoring that amendment. So that's one thing that we can do, is get more co-sponsors, more Congress members to co-sponsor that. It was introduced by Nolan, and it's growing.
What is it?
It's a constitutional amendment that will say that a corporation is not a person and not entitled to constitutional rights, and that spending money is not the same as expressing free speech. So it has to have both of those. There are other ones that have been introduced, but we need both of those prongs for it to be effective. And then it will change. It won't be, you know, the panacea, but it will change so much. So much will become possible once we get that. And California had Proposition 49 towards that end, and it was pulled from the last ballot. But here's another victory. The California Supreme Court just decided, yes, that can go through. It's going to be on the November ballot. Give me a yay! But it goes back to the California legislature, and we have to make sure that the California legislators keep it strong, that it's not enough just to reverse Citizens United. How many of you agree that the corporations had already taken over before 2010? Yeah. So we have to make it strong. It has to say those two things. A corporation isn't a person or isn't entitled to constitutional rights, and money is not speech. And so we've got to lobby our state legislators for that, or they're liable to slip, because at first it was just saying reverse Citizens United. That's not enough. So that's the second thing we need to do. The sixth anniversary of Citizens United is coming up. Who knows the date of that?
21st.
Yes, January 21st. So we always do actions then. We're going to be flyering BART stations this time, and I'd love to have you join the Move to Amend Coalition, Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, and others who care about these matters. Yes, please join us that evening. It's a Thursday from 5 to 7 flyering. And one of the things we're going to be flyering about is stopping the TPP and actions on February 4th. Now, Ralph Nader called the TPP... The worst, the most brazen corporate power grab in American history. That pretty much sums it up. So we got to stop that. We got to do everything we can to stop that. And we've had some victories there. Berkeley and Richmond and a lot of other cities around the country have been declaring themselves TPP free zones. Give me a yay! Yeah, so we need more of those, and that'll be even more important if it passes. It could pass as early as February 4th. Whether or not it passes, there are going to be nationwide actions on February 4th, which is also a Thursday. And there's a map of those, the best website. It's on Move to Amend and many others, but flushthetpp.org is the best one. flushthetpp.org. Yeah, you can find all the actions there and a map of actions. Guess what? There's nothing yet planned for the Bay Area. So right now, I think you are such a wonderful group of change makers. I think we can decide right now what we're going to do on Thursday, February 4th, about the TPP. Just call out, where do you think is the most appropriate place to have a protest in the Bay Area about the TPP?
Federal building.
City Hall.
Federal Reserve Building.
City Hall.
Which City Hall?
Berkeley City Hall.
By the Berkeley.
Well,
it's a national, and okay, any other
Pelosi,
ideas?
Boxer, Feinstein,
Pelosi.
Court.
Court, which court?
Court.
About the ferry station where there's a lot of
ferry station, okay. Maybe we should first decide on a time. How many people are willing to show up on Thursday, February 4th? Please raise your hand. All right. Call out the time that's best. Rush hour, evening, morning, morning maybe before?
Noon.
Noon, noon, I like noon. Let's have a vote. Let's vote on morning rush hour, noon, or evening rush hour. Raise your hand if you like morning rush hour.
Morning.
Okay, raise your hand if you like noon. Raise your hand if you like evening rush hour. Looks to me like noon, but I don't want to be prejudiced. What do you think? Does that look like noon got a few more votes?
Yeah.
Okay, let's do it noon. Okay, now we're going to vote on the place. Federal Reserve Building, Berkeley City Hall, Ferry Building.
Port of Oakland,
uh-huh.
Feinstein's office.
Okay, we got five locations to vote on. Feinstein's office, raise your hand. That's a nice high visibility place, easy to get to. Post Street, San Francisco.
Feinstein's house.
Feinstein's office got more votes. Okay, Ferry Building. Raise your hand if you want Ferry Building. Raise your hand if you want Berkeley City Hall. Raise your hand if you want the, what was the other one? Port of Oakland. Raise your hand if you want the Federal Building or Federal Reserve Building? Federal Building. Federal Building down in downtown San Francisco. Which got the most votes?
Feinstein's office.
I think Feinstein's office got the best votes, the most votes. I think so. Do you agree? Okay, we'll do that at noon, Feinstein's office. High visibility, a lot of people on their lunch breaks. Good. Okay, what else can we do? There is the boycott. You can sign up, and organizations can sign up at flushthetpp.org for a boycott. So we are pledging to buy only local, independent, and fair trade whenever possible. It's not always possible. But if thousands of people do that, that's going to make a big impact.
It's also and used on the bike.
Oh, right, absolutely. Used, recycled, pre-owned. Thank you. So on the anniversary of 21, we're going to be publicizing February 4th. Now, with the Move to Amend Coalition and a lot of the groups, the big issue is growing the movement. And I want to point out Jim McFadden there. Will you stand up, Jim, please? He's the chair of the East Bay chapter of Move to Amend. And Larry Abbott, will you stand, Larry? Also is very active in Move to Amend, very helpful. He's a big union person. And so we are growing this movement, and it's the only thing that ever has and ever will make a difference for us to have a huge movement cross-sector, cross-faction, solidarity with oppressed people. And are there any people of color here tonight? Hardly at all. That's like a big problem. Yeah, and for those of you who are, thank you, and we need to work on that. Another thing you can do is stamp all of your paper cash. There's a station over there. We can stamp it with revolutionary messages, and then as long as it stays in circulation, whoever reads that will get the message. So not to be used for bribing politicians is one, and the system ain't broke, it's fixed. But let's fix it. Thank you.
I do want to throw in, there was a horrible movie made about nuclear power, pro-nuclear, called Pandora's Promise. And in the beginning, they showed Helen Caldicott, and then they showed me, because I was at a rally, and I said, can we all use the F word? And he didn't have me saying the F word. So what is the F word when it comes to nuclear power? Fukushima, right? And what is the F word when it comes to corporate power? Fascism, right? I mean, that is the definition of fascism, is corporate control of the state. Correct. That's Mussolini's decision. I think the definition, I think, was in Italian. But nonetheless, so it's very clear what we're dealing here with. And on the Fukushima side, I want to call Linda Cassini back up really quick. Some of you weren't here before the break, and then Paul Kangas, real quick. We want to talk very quickly exactly what we can do now to shut Diablo Canyon and prevent Fukushima from happening here. And then Paul will tell exactly what we can do. I was asked at the break about solarizing a home here in Berkeley. We all need to know how to do this. So do the state stuff, right? The Water Commission.
and damages.
Okay, very quickly. Number one, Gavin Newsom is the chair of the California State Lands Commission. He has called for a CEQA, California Environmental Quality Act, CEQA analysis of the environmental impacts caused by Diablo Canyon on state land that is being leased from the state by PG&E. Those two leases are set to expire in 2018 and 2019. We need to put pressure on the State Lands Commission to follow up with that CEQA investigation. We need to, everybody in this room has to make comments when the comment period opens. Go to the mothersforpeace.org website. We will keep you informed of all of the actions that you can take to help close down Diablo Canyon. It's a very fast-moving a kind of play that's going on here. We also have the Public Utilities Commission that's going to make the decision about the once-through cooling at Diablo Canyon, building the big cooling towers and getting rid of the 2.5 billion gallons of water that are sucked through there every day to cool those two reactors down. So that is going to be an action that you can take to write your letter to the State Water Commission, the State Water Quality Control Board, for that. And the Public Utilities Commission is going to make a decision about writing that, the expense from $3.5 to $14 billion into PG&E, you're not allowed to run those plants any longer. Support development of renewable energy in any way that you can, locally, statewide, and nationally. Very, very important. We have some articles up on Mothers for Peace website. We have a seismic expert who's made an incredible analysis of the seismic issues at Diablo Canyon. Let's take a couple of minutes. Thank you.
Okay, and remember, on Diablo Canyon, we are very close. And whatever you do in the next year on Diablo Canyon is going to be magnified in impact. And God forbid we should have, you know, we're running this race here. I just bought earthquake insurance on our house in L.A. And, you know, but there's no earthquake insurance on Diablo Canyon. And we don't know when this damn thing's going to blow up. And so, you know, we're in a race against time at Diablo Canyon. And the good news is we really do have a chance to shut it down within the next year. And so please see Linda about it. Please take action. We also have action being taken now on the solar front. Paul's our big guy, and that's it. Go ahead, please.
I asked Harvey the other day, how much time do we have left? He said, maybe 5 years, because of Diablo. That's the problem. We have this roll of the dice happening every day because of Diablo Canyon in this state. We can shut it down. Have you ever heard of a city called Schonau, Germany? It's spelled S-C-H-O-N-A-U. I spent a summer there, and I spent a day there. And these people are just like you people in Berkeley. They were amazing. You know what they did? When the utility would not allow them to sell solar energy onto the grid, you know what they did? They bought the damn grid. That's right. These people put together $1 million out of their pocket. They bought the grid for the town. They now sell. I was in Germany, in Freiburg, and I ran into a couple people from the San Francisco Mud Troop, of course. And they asked me, "You been to Schonau?" I said, "No, what is it?" They said, "It's this little town in the Black Forest, 40 miles that way." I said, "Where's a car I can borrow?" So they gave me a ride to Schonau. We spent the day in Schonau. And I hope I'm pronouncing that right. But this is what's going on over there. And it's going on all over the world. Japan shut down all their nukes. Why? Because of Fukushima. Then they started adding solar. So you can do it one way or the other. You can wait until Diablo melts down and shut down all your lights and then build add solar, or you can do it now. Focus, focus, focus. This is going to be the best 10 years of your life that you've ever seen. The next 10 years is going to be better than the 60s. I promise you. I lived in the Hayden 60s. So what's happening right now, it's spreading all over the country. The state of Maine, here it is. The state of Maine just passed a law saying that if you put solar panels on your house, like 100 of them, the utilities must pay you 33 cents a kilowatt hour. This is a revolutionary breakthrough in this country, because this country is totally controlled by the oil companies, and now Maine has broke the back of the control of that state. So you can now, so you do it here, we can pass laws. The PUC may actually be doing this next month, I don't know. But Maine passed the law saying the utilities must pay 33 cents a kilowatt hour for harvesting solar energy and feeding it onto the grid. Today, as I was coming here, I heard the news from Florida. Florida now has a ballot measure that's almost on the ballot to do the same thing in Florida. Wisconsin is doing the same thing. That's three states already. And no, has anybody here ever heard of this? Did it make the New York Times? No. Did it make the Chronicle? No, and it's never going to make any of these major newspapers because they're controlled by the oil companies. They don't want you. Why do they not want you? Gigi sang a song here about the 99% and how the 1% control us. But what they fear is if you build a house with 100 solar panels on it. Now, I helped a friend here in Berkeley put 20 panels on the roof of her house here. You can do that. You don't want to go through Solar City and get a lease. That's a suicide route. You want to just buy 20 panels and put them on the roof yourself. Talk to me if you want to do it. But this is how you can actually do it. You've got to break the back of the oil companies. We can do it. We're on a roll right now in this country. It's incredible. When I was in Germany a couple years ago, I never thought it would get here. It's here before I knew it. Okay, focus, focus, focus on this issue. This is going to be the best 10 years of your life, I promise you.
Exactly. How can people push solar in Berkeley now? What do we do to get Berkeley solar?
Okay, the most important thing is because you have this great city where you have city council people who actually do things, approach the city council, and I've approached several of your city council members and talked to them, and about putting a thing on the ballot requiring the utilities to pay the solar homeowners for solar energy. Because right now it's illegal to put 20 panels up on your roof, sorry. But you can do it. In India, Gandhi broke the salt tax, where it was illegal to harvest salt out of the ocean. And how did he do it? He went to the ocean, got some salt, and got arrested. But put panels on your roof and get the city council in this city pass a resolution requiring the utilities to pay.
Very good. Thank you, Paul. Cynthia.
I'd like Stephanie Thomas to come up, or whoever's from the East Bay. They're defending the forest. It's a new thing. It's just going to go for 3 minutes. And then right after that, we're going to go into the next little segment. Come on up, Stephanie.
Hello, I'm Stephanie. This is Elena, and that's Ken. And it shrunk our time, but we do have a table back there with lots of information. We're part of a number of groups working to save the East Bay Hills from having hundreds of thousands of trees, big trees, eucalyptus, acacia, Monterey, cut. And application of garland, there's three kinds. Garland is the kind that put a ring around the cambia layer. And glyphosate is sprayed on weeds that they don't like. And so this project started to come in more into the forefront in the early 2000s when UC Berkeley wanted to engage FEMA for money to cut out of trees,
and for the proposition that, you know, for wildfire prevention. So right now, the FEMA report, FEMA money, potential money covers UC Berkeley, City of Oakland, and East Bay Regional Parks. And there's so much more to say, but right now I'll just tell you that the Hills Conservation Network, made up of people, many of whom lost their homes in the fire, lost their family, has a lawsuit against the current FEMA plan. There were 13,000 responses to it, 90% were against cutting the trees, etc. But as soon as the Hills Conservation Network put that plan, lawsuit into effect, the Sierra Club put in a plan against cutting the, against, for cutting the trees, but against lowering the trees cut. So I'll let some of the others share some information.
I'll just say, the main rationale for cutting the trees is to reduce fire risk after the catastrophic 1991 forest storm. But it looks like it may actually increase fire risk in two ways. One is that the cut trees will probably be replaced mostly by brush, including French broom, and weeds, including poison hemlock, both of which are very good at spreading rapidly into any area that's being cleared suddenly. The other way fire risk would be raised a lot is that the tall trees provide lots of fog drip because they reach fog that, lots of, that other plants do not reach. And they also provide shade cover to ground vegetation, which is where fire usually spreads. And they also decrease wind speed just by blocking the wind. Now, I'm not an expert on this, and there's lots of points, but I have an outline of everything that I've found in research. I could give you the web page here, and there's a little piece of paper, if you want.
Thanks. So eucalyptus trees are not our enemies. In fact, they're not mentioned in any fire reports nationally, locally, that they cause fires. The fire, the 1991 fire, the houses got way hotter than trees could ever get, and then the trees burned from the houses, not the other way around. And I want to read you one, two-line quote. Fire science has proven that every living tree, regardless of its species, due to its moisture content and energy cover and canopy coverage of ground, fuels, contributes to wildfire hazard management. It is always better to have a tree because of the bringing down of moisture and moistening the ground, therefore, than not having a tree. We don't want hundreds of thousands of trees cut in this region.